I am very happy to be part of this very short but important ceremony, that is the signing of the loan agreement between the government and the aid bank to allow for the unlending to small business owners whose businesses would have been impacted by COVID-19. I also want to place on record my gratitude to the acting FS and to Honorable Charles and others who were able very quickly to review the agreement to allow for the signing today. I want to place on record also the extraordinarily good relationship and of the World Bank. The World Bank continues to be a very strong partner of Dominica, and I am sure some of them from the World Bank must be watching from the various locations across the world, especially in Washington, D.C. And so I want to let them know that I am personally very grateful for their continued partnership. I also want to thank the IMF for some of the funds that it would have made available to us, some $14 million U.S. dollars, and in a very rapid manner. And those funds are being utilized to assist the forward response to COVID-19.
The hurricane season, as we know, is approaching, and the apartment buildings in Dilis and Laplin will soon be given out to the potential recipients. And this is a big, big boost for the constituency, because we know that's a very vulnerable area in terms of hurricanes and other disasters. And if these apartments are given out, and when, I must say, they are given out, this will serve as a very good boost in terms of hurricane shelters, because the apartments themselves are hurricane resilient. And we were looking around to find where we could find shelters, but the fact that the people will be in a place where they can sit and spend the hurricane, and I'm very, very, very delighted about that. And agriculture too is also being touched as we speak. Agriculture is being given a good boost, because under the World Bank program, the inputs are being given out, the tools are being given out, and all farmers are being touched. And we know what that will mean for production, because we know because of the coronavirus, trade could be affected, and we could grow and feed ourselves. The backyard gardening program is also taking stream in the Laplin constituency. And we encourage people to take advantage of all this, and encourage people to keep following the protocols, keep taking advantage of what the government is offering. And we know things will be better with time to come. Thank you very much.
So presently, we are in the process of handing over our apartment units to 64 beneficiaries in the Grandford community. I am just as excited as the recipients are, especially with the approaching hurricane season. These units have been built to withstand hurricane force winds, and we have in fact allayed the fears of many of our 64 families who will be in those units. No one wants to be reminded of Maria, so in addition to the 64 units, we have also ensured that there is a hurricane shelter within those apartments, and this can safely accommodate 30 other families or 30 other people in the event that they feel their homes are not too safe during the season. In the Monjon River Civic area, we have 14 homes, 14 concrete structures that are either complete or nearing completion. And we are working assiduously to ensure that all these families get into their homes before the hurricane season. This, of course, is the plight of the people in the area. And in addition, it helps the government in that it saves us the trouble of trying to secure other places in the community that can be used as hurricane shelters.
So on the 18th, that was Monday, 18th of May, the WHO, World Health Organization, convened the 73rd World Health Assembly meeting. That was in Geneva. And the purpose of the meeting was basically to elect the president, the vice president, and the executive board of the World Health Assembly, as well as to get national updates and reports regarding COVID-19. And basically, we wanted the World Health Assembly to know what was our situation regarding COVID, what was done, how we went about it. And so we explained to them how we did get our first case on the 22nd of March, and we did explain to them that we actually went to a maximum of 16 cases. And then obviously on the 17th of May, we had zero cases. From our 16 active cases, there were no more active cases on the 16th of May, which we explained to them. And obviously we had to explain how we got to that stage. So we did tell them all about the public health and social measures for our health promotion. That's regarding our respiratory etiquette, which we did, and our physical distancing, and all the washing of hands, and all the sanitizing and disinfecting of our workplaces and our business places, even our homes, etc. So all these public health and social measures did play a part, and we explained that pretty well. We also had to explain to them how significant our approach, which was actually in case identification. We had some extensive case identification exercises with isolation and followed by quarantine. Having said this, we explained how we did build our COVID facility specifically for COVID-19 patients, a separate unit altogether, which was done in Portsmouth. And we expressed that to the assembly as well, which was some of the things that we had to put together to get to where we really wanted to get. And obviously we also had to explain how the borders had to be closed, because that's all part of our approach to the COVID-19 scenario. So that's how we got it done, through public health and social measures, through closure of our borders, and through the just the health promotion and the awareness of the public in adhering to all of these measures that we put in place.